There's a nuclear reactor at the University of Texas, and they agreed to let me try to melt it down. This is a real nuclear reactor, and it is on.
Pulsing reactor in 5, 4, 3.
Nuclear power is the holy grail of clean energy. Uranium has 1.8 million times more energy per kilogram than gasoline. So the amount of uranium you'd need to power your entire lifetime of energy is just the size of a baseball. The trouble, of course, is that harnessing nuclear energy is dangerous. When most people think about nuclear, they think about disasters like Chernobyl or the atomic bomb. But what if nuclear energy didn't have to be dangerous? What if there existed a reactor that was impossible to melt down? Well, it turns out that there might actually be one. Matt Loszak, the CEO and co-founder of Aalo Atomics, invited me down to Texas to see one. He said he could prove that it was impossible to melt down, and I took that as a challenge.
I'm Matt Loszak. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Aalo Atomics, and we're building nuclear reactors that are small and safe enough to fit in your backyard. Our reactors use uranium zirconium hydride fuel. This is also known as TRIGA fuel. The hotter the fuel gets, the less reactive it gets, and therefore it is essentially meltdown proof.
You'll get to see real TRIGA fuel in just a second, but first, yes, this is the shell of what might someday be a nuclear reactor factory. Aalo had literally just moved in when we got there, but they have big dreams for the space.
We could scale this up to a gigawatt per factory per year.
Now, I love startup dreams. I mean, I'm at a startup, my own startup right now, but in order to make a factory of nuclear reactors, they're gonna have to make one working reactor first. Luckily, they don't have to start from scratch. There are a number of working TRIGA reactors scattered around the country today, and they can use those for inspiration. One of them is at the University of Texas, just 14 miles from Aalo's headquarters, and Matt knew the director of the lab. So they agreed somehow to let us come in on a Saturday and do an experiment to try to make the reactor melt down. The TRIGA reactor at the University of Texas is in a totally normal looking building within walking distance of a Starbucks. It's an operational nuclear reactor, and I'm pretty sure that the tech company across the street has no idea that it even exists. Or that me and my friends are gonna try to melt it down.
Okay, so this building is secured and locked down.
We got the safety brief, which was mostly to make sure that we wouldn't get irradiated.
Dosimeter it up, baby.
I'm sorry, test visit.
And we were led directly into the control room of a working nuclear reactor.
We actually like flip switches. I'm not gonna. Those are the real switches that turn the thing on.
And, oh yeah, no, those are all real.
don't touch those switches.
don't.
All right, fine.
This reactor, we run 5 days a week, typically about 8 hours a day, normally.
This is Dr. Charlton, or Bill. He's the director of this lab, and he's worked in nuclear engineering for over 25 years, including a stint at Los Alamos. He's about to talk about his TRIGA fuel, which remember, is the exact same kind of fuel that Aalo uses.
So this is our fuel elements. The fuel itself actually sits in that space right there. That's the fuel. This is graphite, that's graphite, and then it's just clad in stainless steel. And in each one of these, it's basically smaller than a baseball bat, but a heavy. It's heavier than a baseball bat. For people who are not nuclear people, that's really small. It's a very compact system. Our reactor is the size of a trash can, essentially.
So you'll see this entire region right here is all of about 2.5 to 3 feet across. It's relatively small.
Right. There's 114 of these fuel rods in the reactor. They're in a hexagonal lattice throughout the core. It's a very tightly packed lattice.
And so these are sitting vertically like this.
All of those then are at the bottom of a pool of water. The pool of water is about 26 feet deep, and there's about 11,000 gallons of water inside of that pool.
And where are the control rods?
There are four control rods, one there, one there, one there.
Oh, interesting.
One there.
Wow, it's really that. It's only four of these. They're the same size as this. Yeah. Four of these is enough to get it in control.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Yeah, they're worth a loss.
After we got the intro, it was time for our experiment. But first, just to make sure that everybody's on the same page, in this nuclear reactor, like most nuclear reactors, there are both fuel rods and control rods. The fuel rods have uranium zirconium hydride inside, and they make the nuclear reaction happen. The uranium atoms split, which releases neutrons and a ton of energy. Those neutrons then go hit other uranium atoms, which then split and continue that chain reaction. The control rods, conversely, have boron inside, which slows the nuclear reaction down. When the control rods are in the reactor, the reaction is effectively turned off. What that means is that if those control rods are stuck outside of the reactor, then there's nothing slowing the reaction down. It just gets hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter. It can get so hot, in fact, that it melts down, which means that it's so hot, it is literally melting the reactor around it. There are other ways to melt down, to be clear, but that's a big one. You really don't want anything weird to happen to your control rods. But of course, that's why we're here at the nuclear reactor, is to do something strange to the control rods, and Bill agreed to let us try. So here we are. This is a real nuclear reactor, and this is a real experiment to pull out one of the control rods as fast as we possibly can.
Commence the reactor startup, 250 watts perforation for $3 joules.
These three control rods will start roughly two-thirds out, so there'll be the actual nuclear reaction taking place, real fission happening in this very chamber while we're standing right here.
So he's critical at this condition.
And then they will take this rod and then 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Put pressurized air onto that rod, which will then cause that rod to shoot out of the core. That'll then make the reactor go onto its excursion.
That spikes the temperature, it spikes the power.
So it'll go from subcritical to critical to supercritical.
In a normal reactor, it might literally melt the thing down.
Pulsing reactor in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
The reactor and we survived because the reactor's fuel shut itself down immediately after the control rod was ejected. The magic of TRIGA fuel is that it's almost impossible to melt down, even under extreme conditions.
He has the peak power on the pulse was 1435 megawatts. The peak temperature of the fuel was 401 degrees Celsius. Jeez. And the total energy was 23.5 megajoules.
All right, let's translate that. So at the absolute peak, the highest power that it ever produced was 1.4 gigawatts. If you could sustain that for 24 hours a day, that's about enough to power 1 million homes. But of course, that was only for a split second. So the energy that it generated was only 23.5 megajoules. That's not a lot. It's only enough to power one house for about 6 hours. The most important stat, however, is the peak temperature. In Chernobyl, when the core melted down, temperatures peaked at about 1600 degrees Celsius. Our peak temperature here was only 401 degrees Celsius. And after that, to be clear, nothing changed in the reactor. The operator didn't press any special buttons, there were no automated safety measures that kicked in. The fuel itself just made itself colder. How is that possible? Well, it's just due to the incredible chemistry of the fuel that is common to both the Texas reactor and the Aalo reactor, TRIGA fuel, or uranium zirconium hydride.
So you've got uranium and zirconium, those are both metal, and within that metal lattice, you've got these hydrogen atoms. This is dissolved, you know, into the metal. Now, the cool thing about this fuel is that as it heats up, the motion of those hydrogen atoms starts to increase. And when they start to move faster, it becomes less likely that they will slow down the neutrons. And that's why more neutrons leave, less cause fission, and therefore the fuel becomes less reactive.
This effect is known as a negative temperature coefficient of reactivity. In normal conditions, the hydrogen in UZrH hydride is cold or moving slowly. And when it hits a neutron, the odds are high that the neutron will slow down. We want slow neutrons. Slow neutrons have a higher cross-section, which means the odds that they hit a uranium atom, split it, and then the reaction continues. But as the reactor heats up, those hydrogens start jiggling around like crazy, which decreases the odds that they're going to slow down those neutrons. But if those neutrons are allowed to move around quickly, that decreases the odds that they will hit a uranium atom, and the reaction slows down. As the fuel gets hotter, it makes itself colder, because physics demands it. That's why it's almost impossible to melt down, because it keeps itself in control. So if TRIGA fuel is this magical, safe nuclear energy, then why isn't everybody using it? Well, it turns out that there's a real debate about whether it will even work for sustained power production. It might be too safe.
Putting this fuel into a historical context, it's been used in a lot of the TRIGA reactors. It's been used in the SNAP-10A reactor. It's used in like a 10 megawatt Romanian TRIGA reactor, so pretty high power output, but it hasn't really been used for power production at a higher temperature for a sustained period of time. And when we were talking to experts about TRIGA fuel, about this UZrH hydride fuel, we got different responses on whether this would actually be able to serve the purpose of producing power in a reactor. You know, this fuel has not been used for power production before. And some people think it's not going to work for that.
Aalo's bet, of course, is that it will work, and they're going to make some changes to the normal TRIGA design to try to increase their odds. The way that all nuclear reactors convert their fuel to energy is by heating up some liquid, normally water, to generate steam and run a turbine. But Aalo's reactor is different. They actually heat up liquid sodium metal, which then heats up a separate pool of water to generate the steam. This is brilliant because heat transfers so well between metal and metal.
So liquid metal is really this beautiful pairing with this fuel because it unlocks that, you know, that fuel for power production while maintaining that inherent safety. And the way it does that is, you know, metal, when you touch a metal, you know, you know how it feels cold. And it's not because the metal is a lower temperature, it's because the metal is taking the heat from your body faster than when you touch this desk or something like that.
Aalo is still a startup and has a lot to figure out, but I have to admit that I am rooting for these guys. I mean, standing over a live nuclear reactor with somebody is a pretty good bonding experience. But for real, it's hard not to root for Matt, because even if this technology still has a lot to figure out, it has undeniable promise.
So what this technology can unlock is the economics and safety that you'd want for a ubiquitous reactor. I mean, we want to have thousands of these things around the country and one day the world. And that's the only way that we're going to be able to power the future of humanity. The thing that really motivates me is that most of our energy on Earth today comes from oil and gas. And this is crazy because it's going to run out in the next 100 or 200 years. And right now there's millions of people per year that die because of that energy source. And so the only way that we can transition fully off of that is with something like this, where there's a reactor that is safe enough and mass manufacturable enough to be deployed anywhere ubiquitously, safely, economically, and that's what the world needs.
All right, that was unreal. Please like and subscribe and tell me in the comments which technology of the future you'd like me to try out next. Thank you, Aalo, for letting me make you uncomfortable on camera, and thank you to the Nuclear Engineering Teaching and Research Lab at Austin for letting us come in on a weekend and be pretty annoying YouTubers. A special thank you goes out to 50 Years Fund, who is the sponsor of today's episode. 50 Years is an early stage VC fund that funded Astronis, this company, and Aalo, so it's cool to have that connective tissue between these two companies. You guys made this possible, so thank you, 50 Years, for your support. I'll see you next time.